All right. Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see everybody today. If you don't know me, I'm Joe. I'm the lead pastor here at Reality. And I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker here this morning. And he really doesn't need any introduction. It's Josh Simmons, Pastor Josh, that we all love. but he needs to be introduced today because this is actually his last Sunday preaching with us as a full-time staff member here at Reality Church. We both are pretty sure he's going to be preaching more in the future, but his family is following God, what they believe he's leading them towards, and starting a business, actually an Ula Bowl franchise in York. They're going to start sometime in September, October. And so this has been something he's been praying about and working on for quite some time. And we all are really, I know there's a lot of sadness that we have with him leaving us in this way and not having his service to all of us as a staff member, and also just a tremendous excitement that we have in our hearts that Josh is doing something uncomfortable, his family's doing something that's not easy, and they're stepping into something that they believe God's leading them to do. But Josh has been a part of our church for 7 years, and in Reality Church would not be anywhere close to what it is today without his leadership. And I just wrote down a few things that I thought would be good for us to highlight. Josh has prayed with us thousands of times with us individually. Prayer requests that we have, times where we just needed a little bit of support and care and encouragement. Josh was a guy that we went to, and just literally personal prayer requests, Josh has poured over those in our church family. He's held countless meetings with us as a church family, offering godly wisdom. He's helped guide the church with godly wisdom in a really big way, and I'm really personally going to miss him. And on staff, he was a real balance to me at times. So you guys know I'm not always the wisest, at least at first, and need people around me, and Josh was one of those guys. And you know, all the weddings and funerals that he's touched our families with, he helped establish small group culture here at Reality in a really big way. It's really a tremendous strength in our church, as many of us that are involved in smaller settings, and Josh was a key part of that and trained up hundreds of leaders and led events and put his hand of excellence on so many things here at ReChurch. And, you know, Josh has preached over 1,000 times here to us as a church. And we've received his words, his encouragement, his guidance. Our lives are better, and so many of us, our relationship with God is closer as a result of Josh's leadership. So today we're going to hear him one more time as a staff member. After he's finished preaching, I'm going to come back up and I'm going to invite you to give to him a gift of giving back to him in a special way if you'd like to. We're going to pass the buckets. And if any of you would like to give as a present to him and Nikki and their kids as we're sending them off here this morning, you can do it then. So can we give Josh just a big hand as he preaches with us?
All right. How's everybody doing? That's good. What did you say? Oh, how am I? Yeah. I'm gonna be good once this is over. No, just kidding. Did you ever think about how strange this life we get to live is? We are formed in and born out of a belly. This is one of the main reasons I'm glad I'm not a woman. I can't imagine another human being just chilling and growing inside of me. I know it's a beautiful thing, but that thought gives me the heebie-jeebies. This life is strange. We laugh when we're happy. We cry when we're sad or happy. At the end of each day, we lie down, close our eyes, and open them hours later. We eat stuff we call food. We insert it into this hole in our head and swallow it. Some of it stays and some of it leaves post-swallowing. We have feelings, needs, desires, longings. We get excited, jealous, mad, giddy, shy, competitive. We yawn, sneeze, burp, and blush. This life is strange. Sometimes we experience what the French coined déjà vu, where we find ourselves in a place or situation we swore we were in before but really weren't. That's weird. We exist on a speck-sized ball floating in outer space that's flying around a way bigger ball of fire and gas that's 109 times its size at 67,000 miles per hour, while at the same time spinning close to 1,000 miles per hour, and yet we don't feel any of that happening. But do you want to know one of the weirdest things you can experience in this life? Waking yourself up from laughing. This ever happened to you? You're in this deep sleep when you begin to hear this faint laughter that gets louder and louder, only to discover it's your own, and it's woken you up. What adds embarrassment to this weirdness is having someone else wake you up because your laughing was so loud it woke them up, but they don't think it's funny. The other night, my wife had to shake me awake because I was laughing in my sleep. You would think that as soon as I was awake, the laughing would cease, right? Oh, no. I kept on going because apparently what I was chuckling at was so funny, it didn't matter if my eyeballs or brain were open for business. The thing is, I actually remembered what I was laughing at. Are you ready to hear what was so hilarious? In my dream, one of my buddies made pancakes with chewy blueberries. As part of the dream, I remember saying something about them being chewy like gum and laughing hysterically at my own joke. I laughed for 10 additional minutes after being awake from that make-believe experience. I had to leave the bedroom. I ran out with my hand covering my mouth to silence the giggles. I was standing alone, half bent over in the dark living room, cracking up, and I didn't even know why. I remember feeling embarrassed. I was like, get a grip, dude. You are a grown bearded man who's still laughing about chewy blueberries. Your wife thinks you're a clown. Go back to sleep and dream about something that's worth laughing about. Or about something that's going to change the world or help someone. Do you want to know what the ultimate weird is, though? It's when this crazy, strange, magnificently beautiful life we get to temporarily wander around in becomes normal. That is insane. That is crazy, if you think about it. How could this life in this world ever become normal? For quite possibly my last sermon, at least as a pastor on staff at Reality Church, I wanted to implore all of us, including myself, we can't ever mistake this life we get the privilege of living as normal. This is all far from normal. This is extraordinary. And it will be over before we know it. One day soon, Jesus will be the one nudging us awake, and what will have felt like a crazy, weird dream will have been our lives. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be embarrassed about that. I want to live the kind of life worth retelling. I want to live the kind of life my kids, my family, my friends, my neighbors, acquaintances, and even strangers want to retell. I want to leave us with four ways to keep this life from being normal. Four ways to live an extraordinary life. Four ways to heed the wisdom of Romans 13. Make sure that you don't get so absorbed and exhausted and taking care of all your day-by-day obligations that you lose track of the time and doze off oblivious to God. Because the night is about over, and dawn is about to break. So be up and awake to what God is doing to keep this life from being normal, to live an extraordinary life. We'll need to respond appropriately. There are so many people who are living for God with this reluctant obligation. With this posture that says, God, I don't want to, but I guess I have to. So many people are doing the right thing or not doing the wrong thing out of reluctant obligation. But reluctant obligation isn't the heart of God, and reluctant obligation doesn't match up with what God has done. Jesus came so reluctant obligation would never be the reason we follow him or don't follow him. If you're following Jesus out of reluctant obligation, you're missing something. Something is out of whack. Something isn't right. It reminds me of a story in the Bible about when two men were possessed by evil spirits. Jesus sees them and cast out the demons into a herd of pigs that then run off a cliff and die. Matthew tells us that the herdsmen fled to the nearby town, telling everyone what happened to the demon-possessed men. Then the entire town came out to meet Jesus. But they begged him to go away and leave them alone. Something is really messed up with this story. Something is out of whack. Something isn't right with their response. They heard what happened. They saw the once demon-possessed men now completely healthy and whole, but they wanted Jesus to leave them alone. Is it just me? Or is their response not appropriately matching up with what just happened? I mean, we see in other times and places, the crowds of people follow Jesus everywhere. They couldn't get enough of him. So why not these people? Why did this entire town want Jesus to leave? Well, I believe it's because they liked how things had been. They knew that if Jesus stuck around, other things may be released and uncovered. Maybe that's been our something's not right, something's out of whack, something's messed up response to Jesus. And maybe we've reluctantly obligated to follow Jesus because we haven't allowed Jesus to deal with what's been possessing us. But not everyone in that town agreed with the majority. Luke tells us the men who had been freed from the demons begged to go with him. That response makes sense. That matches up with what happened. Those who actually experienced Jesus wanted more of Jesus. Those who didn't were reluctant. Often when Jesus moves close, when the Spirit of God seems to be directing you and nudging you and counseling you, he's going to ask you to hand something over. Some kind of exchange will often be required, and it won't seem like a fair trade at first. But God, I like that music, those movies, those people, that job. God, I kind of like what I do with my spare time, my money, my gifts. But God, I kind of like holding on to this unforgiveness, this grudge, this bitterness, this worry, this anger, this attitude. And so often what happens, because we can't imagine anything better, and because that's what we're used to and stuck to, and because it's much easier to walk by sight than not by faith, we hold on to what we have and what we know, and instead of begging to go with Jesus, we tell him to leave us alone, and we miss out on what could have been, what should have been moments that would have led us to something much greater. What would Jesus need to do or say to you that would change your status from reluctantly obligated to fully following? What would he need to do or say to help you respond more appropriately to all he's done for you and wants to do for you? There was this park that I would pass by almost every day. From the street, it didn't look like much. But one day, for whatever reason, I pulled in, parked my car, got out, and started walking. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Acres of walking past, beautiful trees, a stream, a bird sanctuary. They had this one tree that grew blue neon flowers in the spring. You couldn't see any of that from the road. It became our family's favorite park. A place where I loved to run and read. We played with our kids there. Invented new games there. Went sledding there. Had birthday parties there. Had great conversations there. Thousands of memories were created from that one decision to not pass it by. I was grateful that I found it, that I made the decision to turn into it, but I was disappointed that I didn't do it sooner. Maybe God has been like that park for you. Through the passenger side window, it doesn't look like much. But you have no idea what's just over the hill. Or how turning down that driveway will not just impact you, but those you love. If you would just get out of the car and start walking toward him, he will overwhelm you and you will see things and experience things you never thought you would. God is always in town, but he's not just going to barge in on us. It's our response that will determine how much of him we get to experience. And there is only one response that makes sense when it comes to who he is and what he's done. It's either one where we're begging him to stay, or it's one where we're begging to go with him. To keep this life from being normal, to live an extraordinary life, we'll need to respond appropriately, but we'll also need to, and this may sound familiar to some of you, be interruptible. How interruptible are you? Are you able to be interrupted? Generally, how do you typically respond to interruptions? Before even hearing and getting into exactly what that means, how is your heart responding to this question? If I had to guess, many of us don't like the answer our heart is giving. And the reason I can safely assume that is because what normal and sane human being likes being interrupted? Every parent that's probably ever lived has experienced this kind of beckoning from their child when you were busy doing something or talking to someone. Mom, 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 dad, 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 dad. Some of you are getting heart palpitations right now and hearing that, even though you know it's coming from a grown man's lips and not your kids. All of us have had the washing machine or the car break down at the most inopportune time and interrupt what was needed to get done, causing a priority pileup. Big reason we struggle so much with this is because we live in a society and culture that drives and promotes getting things done, even at the expense of others and what's really most important. And that current of moving forward, of achieving, of accomplishment can get so ingrained and embedded in us that we don't even question it anymore. It's become a part of us and how we function. Walking on by starts feeling easier and easier to do. The justifications, the excuses that once may have worked are not suiting us anymore. Preaching to myself here, I still catch myself hurrying for no reason at all sometimes. Did you ever see me in a store? Probably not, because I'm usually teetering between speed walking and jogging from aisle to aisle. Why? I have no idea. I'm likely hurrying to get nowhere important as quickly as possible. What about you? Do you find yourself driving too fast, too impatient, when you really had nothing urgent to get to? Do you know what I'm discovering and what I see in so many people? We're not just addicted to busy, but to the appearance of busy. In other words, when we've got nothing to get to, when nothing is demanding something from us, we still feel this magnetic pull to get to something, to fill that empty space with something. And whether your life is actually and legitimately packed too full, or you're just moving around empty boxes to look the part, if there's no wiggle room for life's unexpected, if there's no margin for the unpredictable, everything starts to look like an interruption. Everything starts to look like an enemy. Our kids, our pets, our lifeless appliances, the checkout lady, the driver, the gas cap that won't go on right, the person God is actually talking to us to talk to spend time with, they begin to look like just another obstacle that's getting in the way of our plans getting accomplished. When we live this uninterruptible kind of life, oftentimes the world seems to be against us, which we often internalize as God being against us. Interruptions. We never go looking for them. We rarely give them a warm greeting. Seldom do we enjoy their company. They slow us down. They keep us from doing what we want to do. They keep us from going where we want to go. But what if we've been looking at them completely the wrong way? What if interruptions are exactly what we need? And what if God uses interruptions as invitations? What if in those seemingly empty, annoying, and frustratingly inconvenient plan-killing moments are opportunities for God to work and move in and through us in ways that he couldn't without them? Do you know what the definition of interruption is? It's a break in the continuity of something. Isn't this exactly what we need so often? Don't we need something or someone stronger and wiser than us to shake us out of these monotonous, going-nowhere grooves we get ourselves into? And isn't this where we would expect our good and loving Heavenly Father to be? right in the middle of these ugly, messy moments where what we want is being taken from us or delayed. Right in the middle is these moments where we're so often at our worst. Right in the middle is a God who's trying to get our attention, to help us see what we can, to invite us into something better. There is this iconic story that Jesus tells that would have shocked his audience. A religious leader, a Pharisee, trying to trap Jesus into saying something against God and their traditions, asks him, "Who is my neighbor?" And Jesus does the unthinkable. He crafts a parable that allows a despised bottom of the totem pole Samaritan to come out as more righteous than the religious leaders and church staff. Luke 10:30, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was. And when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to the inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.'" Jesus, an unlikely hero, despised and rejected by the very ones he created, crossed the borders of eternity and came to where we were. Beaten by our sin and left to die, he saved us, healed us, and paid the debt we couldn't pay. He threw our sins upon his cross and smothered us in grace and mercy and forgiveness enough to cover any other sins we would commit the rest of our stay. Jesus wants them and us to see that man lying on the street. That's you. That's me. That so-called, so-thought inconvenience, that's you, that's me, that's why I'm here, that's why I came. You see, God calls us into the interruptions because he knows that once we get close enough, we'll see it's not really an interruption after all, it's an invitation. See, unless we get close enough, from the other side, it always looks different. From across the street, it looks like hassle. From a distance, it looks like time lost and financial loss. From the other side, it looks like someone else will take care of it. From the other side, it doesn't seem like that big of a deal, but up close, it looks and feels totally different. Up close is where we see ourselves. We remember that was us once. Up close is where we see and experience the love and the compassion of Jesus and an invitation to offer it to someone else. And all of a sudden, nothing seems more important. Nothing seems better. There's no other place we'd rather be. To keep this life from becoming normal, to make it extraordinary, we've got to respond appropriately. We've got to be interruptible. And number three, we've got to live life like it's temporary. About a year ago, I found myself behind a truck that had a sign on the back of it that read, It's temporary, with the name of someone beside it, which I assumed was a loved one that passed on from this life. And when I pulled up behind the truck that day, I wasn't taking my own advice. I wasn't adhering to my favorite, most repeated truth I tell myself, that worry never changes anything for good. I was worrying intensely about something, trying to fix something that I had no power to fix or change, to the point where I was experiencing unpleasant physical symptoms from it. I was treating it like it was a permanent, this is going to go on forever thing. I was fixating on it like that was all there was to see. This morning, I believe God wanted me to repost this sign up for you all to see and digest as well. This morning, he wants to remind you it's temporary. It's temporary. The season, this heartache, this loss, This difficulty, this pain, this trial, this wealth, these things, this life, it's not permanent. It's temporary. Don't we all seem to live believing that we won't ever get old? When we're kids, we can't even picture being our parents' age. And when we're our parents' age, we can't imagine being our parents' age. We can't see ourselves looking like that, thinking like that, walking like that, getting bent out of shape about that. And then we have these special moments where we catch a glimpse of their reflection in us through how we parent, fold laundry, mow the lawn, cut carrots. We notice similar smile and frown lines that have been carved seemingly overnight through our forehead and cheeks. And yet, with all the evidence, we just can't see ourselves there as old. Someone said denial exists when three beliefs intersect. The belief that it cannot happen, the belief that it cannot happen to you, and the belief that it cannot happen to you now. I wonder how many of us are in denial about our own mortality, that it will happen, that it will happen to you, that it could happen to you at any time, that one day you won't be here, doing the things you've always done, going to the store to get milk, planning the summer vacation, having coffee on the deck, playing golf with the guys, sitting down to watch a movie with your kids. The sooner we start living in our reality, the quicker we stop denying our mortality, the better the chance we start living the kind of life worth waking up from. Did you know that the Bible never records Jesus running? As far as we can tell, Jesus never ran. He walked. He took his time. We like to run, don't we? Running seems better, faster, smarter. We get more done when we run. Now, there certainly isn't anything wrong with hustle. And sometimes life will require you to run around. But when it becomes your standard, when you don't feel comfortable without it, when it bleeds into how you parent and how you neighbor and how you family and how you treat people on a consistent basis, that's when running can cause us to miss the most important things. And when we miss the most important things long enough, our lives become about the less important things. Jesus walked. He walked in a peaceful but purposeful way, and people were attracted to that. We should be attracted to that. The world around him didn't dictate his pace, his purpose. They didn't pull him away from what was most important, which leads us to our fourth and final way to keep this life from becoming normal. To make it extraordinary, number four, we've got to make every moment matter. What if we strive to believe that the most important moment is always the moment you're in? Imagine if we believed that, remembered that, and lived that. This is how Jesus lived. This is what Jesus believed. Jesus was constantly trying to get his followers to slow down, to be more fully present in their moments. We can find one example of many in Luke chapter 18. Jesus is walking into Jericho, this magnificent walled city with large crowds fighting for attention. It was always slightly chaotic when Jesus came to town. At this point, everyone had heard about Jesus, the man who heals, performs miracles, and teaches with truth and grace. There isn't one person who isn't trying to at least get a glimpse of Jesus, but many of them want way more than that. They're looking for him to sign a sandal or a forehead. Many are trying to touch him in hopes that their diseases and ailments would be fixed. And in the midst of all of this, there is a small group of people that have placed themselves in front of Jesus as his self-assigned bouncers, choosing who and when someone can even call out to him, hushing those who don't have the look or the right vibe. A blind man named Bartimaeus is calling out for Jesus. It doesn't matter how loud, how chaotic, how embarrassing, he wants to get Jesus' attention. And he's not going to quit shouting despite the self-appointed judge and jury telling him to be quiet. But do they have a point? They're probably thinking, we've walked past at least 100 people who were sick, who needed healing, who wanted an autograph. They're probably thinking, Jesus doesn't have time for this guy. Jesus is going somewhere. He's too important. He's too busy. Jesus has an agenda. Jesus isn't going to stop for this guy begging on the side of the road. But for some reason, Jesus hears this guy. And Jesus calls for this guy and he asks them, "What can I do for you?" I mean, there are thousands of people. But Jesus isn't taking his eyes and attention and focus off this man. And at this point, Bartimaeus is literally crying out, "Could you heal me? Would you heal me?" And with just a few words spoken, he can see and he joins the others in following after Jesus. What would happen? How would our lives be different if we didn't allow the world around us to dictate and determine our pace, our purpose, like Jesus and Bartimaeus did? Jesus was always fully present in the moment, and he gives people one of the greatest gifts he can give, his undivided attention and love. Jesus didn't heal every single person in his lifetime, and he doesn't heal every person in this lifetime. I don't know why all the whys and why nots to that, but I do know this. Jesus will never run past a moment to be fully present and engage with those who cry out to him. We may not get the miracle we're asking for, but we'll always get the miracle of God wanting to come and meet with us, nose to nose, eye to eye, heart to heart. I don't know about you, but I want to be more like Jesus. I want to live more like Jesus lived. The way Jesus lived is attractive to me. He was fully present in every moment along the way. He was open and sensitive to what those moments could bring. I fail at this a lot. In fact, I was so bad at this that around 10 years ago, God gave me a few words to help me see what I was doing, and it stuck with me ever since. God told me, don't spend the majority of time living for the minority of time. I want to encourage you with these words as well. Don't live for the weekend. Don't live for the 1 or 2 week vacation. Don't live for the wedding day. Don't live for quitting time. Don't live for the end of the last class. Don't live for graduation. Don't live for this temporary life. We are not called to live for the moment. We're called to live in the moment. And we've been given life with a very brief window of time, and we've got to fight against the temptation to treat our days as filler, as days to get through, to get to the days we want to live in. There's a big difference between living for the moment and living in the moment. When you live in the moment, you maximize the minutes and the moments you have. No days are filler. Each day is equally and wonderfully important. You look people in the face. You don't wish you were somewhere else. You have an opportunistic and expectant outlook. You hold this belief that how you live matters, that something, someone is connecting the dots of your life. Like Colossians 1:17 says, he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. When we live with this kind of outlook, with this kind of expectant reverence for each day, this God, this day is yours, you're holding all of this together, you start asking questions like, God, would you help me to slow my life down enough to see where you're stepping? You'll start asking questions like, would you help me to quiet my life down enough to hear what you're saying, how you're directing? Harvard did a study, and what they found out, and this is their exact words, 47% of the time, people's minds are not in the same place their feet are. 47% of the time that you're in a conversation with someone, your mind isn't fully engaged. 47% of the time, you're sitting in church or at dinner with the family or engaged with someone at work or talking with someone at the gym. Almost half of your waking life, your mind is not fully engaged where the rest of your body is. Hundreds of times a day you aren't with whatever or whoever is in front of you, and either your mind is somewhere else or you're keeping yourself from someone else. There's so many ways we do this. Besides our phones, which the average person touches 3,000 times a day, most of us are overachievers. We do that, they say, double the amount of times. But more than that, maybe you often allow your mind to play the when-then game. When I get to high school, then it will be better. When I'm a senior, then I'll be happy. When I find a guy or a girl to love, then life will start. When I get a real job, when I get married, when I have kids, when I don't have to wake up with kids, when I get a house. So many of us We are literally wishing away the current moment, wishing away what you have in front of you, and we miss what we have now, pursuing what we want later. Psalm 39:4 should be taped to our mirror. Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. There is a ticking clock counting down to the day we leave this temporary rental space and move into our permanent residence, and none of us knows how long our countdown is. If it's not the when-then game that keeps us out of our real-time moments, it's the what-if game. It's projecting into the future. What if this happens? What if I don't pass this test? Then what if I don't get into a good college? Then what if I don't get a good job? Then what do I have to live if I have to live with my parents till I'm 60? What if this happens? What if that happens? What if aliens attack? And on and on and on. Jesus said, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. In other words, today's big enough. Live in today. For many of us, we're either freaked out about something that happened a long time ago, or we're freaked out about something that might happen. If this is you, if this is where you're currently at, the only way we're going to stop missing our moments, to enjoy the life in front of us, to face our life in front of us, is to surrender the past you can't change and trust God with the future that you can't control. And you can do that. You can do that because God redeems the past and God holds the future. And because of that truth, because of that fact, the very best thing you can do is to let go of what you have absolutely no power over anyway and let God do what only he can do, so that you can fully engage with the what, where the could be, that's in front of you, all that he's calling you to. I don't know who this is for, but you can't serve Jesus where you're not. And you can't be happy and fulfilled where you're not. And you can't love people where you're not. And if your mind is not where your body is, 47% of the time you're missing out on the life that God has for you right now. You can't be a great friend if you're not there. You can't be an engaged mom or dad if you're not there. You can't have a great marriage if you're not there. And you don't know the impact that you could have or could have on someone. That's what my good friend said to me a couple years ago when we were out to dinner. At the time, he had recently been released from spending weeks in the hospital with COVID pneumonia. He almost died. He's sitting in this room today. Before going to the hospital, he couldn't even get himself off the couch to get in the car to be driven there. And we're out eating together, and we're joking and laughing, and we're having a great time. But then the conversation shifted. And my friend, he slides his perfectly seasoned and perfectly cooked pork chop to the side. And with tears filling his eyes, he said, I don't know if what I would have done, or if I would have survived without the prayers and the text and the calls and the messages that made it to me. He said, I always knew relationships were important, but this experience really showed me how valuable and life-giving and life-saving they were. He said, Josh, I could literally feel the prayers of my friends and people going to God on my behalf. And then he told me about this guy who came up to him after he had been home, and he said to him, he said, you scared me. I thought I was going to lose you. And my friend knew this guy, but didn't know him that well. He said, God showed me in that moment how much of an impact we can have on people. He said, even with my little interaction with this individual, I had an impact. And then he said this. He said, imagine how much more we can have if we were more present. My fully recovered friend and his wife had a word that year. Intentional. That's a good word. Would you stand with me? Would you join me in striving to engage in the everyday moments to be where your feet are? Jesus made this clear. Love God and love people. Everything we say and do should pivot off of these two commands. His most important, must be our most important. Before you go after your moments, I want to leave you with these thoughts. Our kids, our families, our friends don't deserve us. They deserve a much better us. They deserve a Christ directing our hearts us. Our spouse or future spouse doesn't deserve us. They deserve someone much better than what we can give, what we can do. They deserve a Christ living through us. Our neighbors, the people we walk past, interact with every day, the strangers we'll meet only once. They need and deserve a Christ ruling our hearts us. The world needs a version of us that we can't create, that no amount of education, hard work, self-cleaning, good looks, and talent can make. This version can only be made through our own moment-by-moment, crying out, nose-to-nose, eye-to-eye, personal interactions with the Father. That's what Jesus was showing us he wanted when he walked among us. He wants us, and he wants us to want them, to be present and intentional with them as he is with us, as we are with him, to keep this life from being normal, to live an extraordinary life. We'll need to respond appropriately, be interruptible, live like it's temporary, and we'll need to make every moment matter, because reluctant obligation will always be the wrong, doesn't match up response. And because in every interruption, there's an invitation to experience the compassion, grace, mercy, patience, and love of God. And because this isn't it, our mortality isn't our reality. But because of Jesus, it's our destiny. We were made for eternity. Because how you live matters. Something, someone is connecting the dots of your life. Let's live lives that are worthy of what's been given to us. Because this life, in this world, this is all far from normal. This is extraordinary. And it'll be over before we know it. So make sure you don't get so absorbed and exhausted in taking care of all your day-by-day obligations that you lose track of the time and doze off oblivious to God. The night is about over. Dawn is about to break. Be up and awake to what God is doing. God is putting the finishing touches on the salvation work he began when we first believed. We can't afford to waste a minute. We must not squander these precious daylight hours in frivolity and indulgence and sleeping around and dissipation and bickering and grabbing everything in sight. Get out of bed and get dressed. Don't loiter and linger, waiting until the very last minute. Dress yourselves in Christ and be up and about. Amen. You guys can be seated. I think Joe's going to come up and embarrass me some more.
All right. It's Nikki. Nikki, where are you? Can you come on up here? Any of the staff members want to come on up? But you guys, we're going to just spend a few moments praying for Josh and just blessing him. Morgan and Mackenzie, you got to do it. Could we just, as a church family, you might want to extend your hands out to them, but join me in this prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Josh and his leadership, his humility, his love, God, of you. Father, we thank you for the way that you've put something special and unique on his heart, a change, God, that years ago, I don't know if he would have expected it, but yet he was obedient to you, God, as you kept prodding and talking to him and Nikki and the girls. And Father, he's leaving something that he loves. He loves this church. Lord, he loves what he's doing here, and he's stepping into what he believes, God, you are leading him and his family to do. And so, God, this morning we know that that's a special thing, to have faith to make a change like that, Lord, when we don't know exactly how it's all going to go. And so, Lord, we bless him today. We bless Nikki and Morgan and Mackenzie. Father, we pray that the faith they have in their hearts today would get even stronger, Lord, their trust of you to be used by you in a new way, to see your kingdom come and your will be done in York as it is in heaven. Lord, would increase that, God, it would just even get stronger. Father, we pray your blessing over this family as financially, Lord, as they step into the unknown in that as well. God, that's not easy for us. And so, Lord, we pray that this path that you've opened up for the Simmons family, this path that they've stepped onto, God, would get clearer and clearer and just would be filled with things, Lord, that are from you. Lord, we pray for surprises for Josh and Nikki and Morgan and Mackenzie, each of them. We pray, Lord, that it wouldn't just be servant Ula Bowls, but there would be things, Lord, that come, that they discover in their hearts, discover about you, God, that is going to take them through this season in a very, very special way and even beyond. Lord, we thank you for Morgan and Mackenzie and the special experience that they get to have as children moving with their parents into something new and something unknown. And Father, we pray especially for them that, God, these surprises would be revealed to them and things for their plans and your plans and purposes for them in the future would be continue to be revealed. And Lord, today, as a church family, we share in the experience of being moved by you to step into the unknown. Father, you've put things on our hearts as a church, individually and corporately, that are beyond what we can do on our own. And so, Father, I pray that Josh's example here this morning would be something contagious to us. That, Lord, we wouldn't be afraid. But, God, we would recognize how short life is, how much sometimes it's important to be interrupted, and we would move into the waves of your Spirit to follow Jesus wherever it is that he's asking us to go. So we thank you for that, Lord. We love Josh and Nikki. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, guys. Yeah, awesome. Awesome. Let's clap for them. Well, we're going to receive an offering now for them, so if the ushers could come and just start passing the buckets. You can pass those buckets down the row, and if you've already got the bucket, you could just set it on the side there. And feel free to give anything you'd like to. There's also a QR code that's on the screen behind us. I think it'll be up there. You can use that and just mark it, go to designated and mark it for Josh, and we're going to put it all together and just write a check to them. So we have one more way, you guys, that we want to celebrate Josh and Nikki and Morgan and Mackenzie with some of Josh's special foods. Many of you probably know this because he's talked about these things over time, but Josh loves King's Rolls. You guys know what King's Rolls are? King's Roll, I think that with butter, a special kind of butter he likes. And he's a huge macaroni and cheese fan, which is so weird, man. But he's always loved macaroni and cheese, so we've got some homemade macaroni and cheese out there, but you've got to eat it with applesauce. So we've got applesauce as well. And, you know, I had it wrong first service. I thought you were supposed to take the macaroni and cheese and applesauce and mix it all together. And Josh says, no, 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 no. So you scoop the mac and cheese, dip it in a little applesauce, and then you eat it. So we all have to eat it that way. Sounds amazing, doesn't it? Anyway, you guys, let's hang out a little bit together as a church family. Josh is ready for lots of hugs, so you can hug him as much as you want today. And just let's bless him here this morning as we go. So you guys have a great Sunday. Meet someone you don't know today, and we'll see you next week. You gave me a home within your love. I was running blind until you showed me that life could be this good. I want all my friends to know.